Good morning to you all.
Good morning.
If you want to be a leader, you must have confidence. And I can measure your confidence from the way you talk. So we're going to learn all those things. I am going to be as practical as possible. All the things I've put down, we are going to box theory and practice. Some of you will be aspiring to study outside and work outside. Fortunately, I have those experiences. I lived and worked here, lived and studied outside, and what have you. So we'll be mixing them up for you to know that, like Dr. Yorson said, the modern trend. One thing I noticed, and which I pointed out to Dr. Yorson, in the modern times, lateness is not acceptable. You can't be a leader who is not mindful of time. Time is everything. In business, time is money. When you miss 1 minute, you've missed a lot. So I want you to take note that as a leader, punctuality is so essential because you have to lead by example. If you're a leader and you go to work late, that's it. Others will come to work what? Late. Now, what we'll be discussing today will be I was going to say emotional intelligence. I teach emotional intelligence. I was told that you just had it. Leadership and motivational skills. So we will look at, we will see some theoretical aspect of it, what makes you a leader, what you have to do. The outline I had was that you will, I will look at, usually what I like is that I will always want to come out with a working definition that we used to do. And these are the things that will, at least you go home with one word or two words in mind. So we will talk about this. So we'll look at the leadership skills. Why should you have skills as a leader? The sources of the skills. We'll also be interested in the personality traits. We all have various traits. Where are those traits coming from? So that's what I mean by the source. How to develop your leadership skill set? And then what is motivation? Because remember the topic is leadership and motivational skill. So we'll finish with leadership. Then we'll look at motivation. Motivation is a broad topic. And when I'm teaching motivation, I look about 2 or 3 days. It's a lot, but I've been able to put together to condense it for our purpose. Is that okay? So motivational skills. Reasons why a leader must motivate team members. And then expected challenges in developing motivational skills and how to deal with them, all right? Okay. So, what is leadership? You want to be a leader. What is leadership? It's a relationship through which one person influences the behavior or actions of the other people. The key word here is influences. And it's always what? A relationship between one and other people. So the word here is what? A relationship. Okay? Currently, I am leading you. So I have that. We are having that relationship of me facilitating and you listening, okay? And I'll be trying to influence you to take, to understand the main topics or the main issues at stake. So the word influence is very, very important. And here, the behavior and actions of that individual. So I'm influencing you to behave in a certain way or to behave in a manner that will help us realize our objective. Is that okay? Good. The next one is leadership is the process of influencing others to understand and agree about what needs to be done and how to do it, and the process of facilitating individual and collective efforts to accomplish shared objectives. You see, I've quoted them. They are not my words. I'm using an authority. That's how you do it. You pick it from an authority and you develop it. All right? Until you write your own book. Then somebody can also quote you. So you see the word influencing is here. Okay? And always know that it's a process. That means it's what? It's a continuous thing. Okay? So the process of influencing others to understand. You need to understand and agree. So that we agree on what needs to be done. For instance, this project, there was some communication and other things and understanding, and there was an agreement that was, you'll be here this morning for us to start it. Is that okay? So Dr. Yorson set all these things, the process in motion and all that. And even it's not going to end after the lecture, he's going to put it out and all that. So we'll be trying to do that. So it's always a process. And what needs to be done and how to do it. Okay? Does that? And then we have what? We need to accomplish shared objectives. Does that make sense? When you are a leader and you are influencing people to do something, there is a shared objective, something we've all agreed to do. That is why at the end of it all, he's going to ask you, you'll be asking questions, and then you'll be tested and all those things, because they want you to acquire the skills. Is that okay? Any questions so far? So we are going home with what? When we talk about leadership, with what? Let's talk about the keywords. Relationship, good. Influence. Continuous process. It's a process. And then what else? Individuals and groups. Good. And what else?
Objectives.
Is that okay? It's not going to be a chew and pour. I want you to understand, by the time you leave here, you've understood something that you can walk away with and you can practice. Is that okay? Good. So, what do you mean by leadership skills? You see, because you've now understood leadership, we can talk about leadership skills. Is that okay? Good. What do I mean by that? Leadership skills are skills you use when organizing other people to achieve a shared goal or objective. You see, we have a goal, we have an objective, and you are organizing them or you are trying to influence them for us to achieve the shared goal. And so the skills you are going to use, do you understand me? You must have certain skills to use so that the people following you or the people you are dealing with, your people you are handling, will be able to assist you in achieving the shared objectives. So that is what we mean by this. So the leadership skills are required at all levels of leadership in organizations. And then management level, middle level, etc. Schools, classrooms. Do you have your class captain? Where is the class captain? Good. How do you see his leadership skills? What does he use? Okay, class captain, what do you use to when you want something, you want them to do something, the lecturer has told you something, or you want the group to do something, what sort of skills do you use? Yes, so tell me. I'm not saying, yes, that's very important. It depends, the context. The context, that's very important. He said it depends. It means he's talking about the context, the situation. All right, yes. Communication. How do you communicate? So it's one of the key skills. That's very good. So how do you communicate? It's not a matter of just communicating. We have what we call effective communication. You just can't talk. You have to make sure that... Okay, so communication, what else? Okay, now those of you he leads, what are some of the skills you have identified with him, his leadership skills? Yes. It leads by example. Brilliant. So you see, you have certain skills you must have to get people to do what you want you want them to do, or even the collective goal. All right? So now leadership skills require one to motivate others to complete a single task, a series of tasks, to meet the timelines and schedules. You must always have timelines. You must always have schedules. If you're a leader, you want them to get certain things done, there must always be what? Timelines. Otherwise, Dr. Yoshin got in touch with me, said, okay, I want this thing, and the date is 28th February. Even if I'm even watching the crossroads, this on TV, I knew that I had to be here 28th February, this time and all that. Timelines are very important to get the job done. All right? Okay. So effective leadership requires a combination of several different skills working together. You remember he said it depends. So when we talk about you, the leader, getting things done, you need to look at so many skills, a combination. The key word here is what? Combination of several skills. So you have combination, you have several, and then you have your skills. These are the words of importance as far as this is concerned. Why are leadership skills important? And we are saying effective leaders are essential for the survival of any organization. If you survive, if the organization will survive, you need to have not leaders, but we must have effective leaders. People who are effective, who make things happen. Africa, we are lacking behind because most of our people we call leaders are not leaders. Quote me anywhere. I'm prepared to debate. Most of the people we have in positions, in our churches, everywhere, they are not leaders because they are not effective. So we are not getting things done. They are not taking care of our needs. So if you want to be a leader, you must be seen as being effective, addressing the needs of the people. Some companies collapse. They still have leaders, but companies collapse. Look at our financial institutions. Didn't they have CEOs and what have you? They had so many of them, but most of them has gone into administration. So our purpose here is for us to become effective leaders and not just leaders. Effective leaders can assist in building stronger teams within an organization. They assist in building what? Stronger teams. Now, effective leaders ensure that projects, initiatives, work, etc., function, are performed successfully. If they cannot get things done successfully as expected, they are not effective. We only want, most of them are interested in the titles and not responsibilities. Those of you who came in, he has just gone against the law. Class captain, you were here when we talk about the basic ground rules. All right? Okay. The thing is that if you need something, you raise your hand, you ask. The ground rules. And if you are a leader and you cannot enforce rules, forget it. Don't make the rules. Do you understand me? Leaders are who cannot enforce rules. Ghana, we have all the rules in the world, but we cannot enforce them. That's why our country is in the state that we find it. So if you know you cannot enforce the rule, don't come out with the rule at all because it will undermine your authority. And that's why Ghana, when the laws come out, they say, oh, well, give themselves two, 3 minutes. And people driving on the pipeline, driving the way people drive recklessly and what have you, they know that they won't be sanctioned. But elsewhere, those who drive like that, when they get to Europe, and they won't drive like that because the laws will bite. Do you understand me? Yes. So that is why your generation must ensure that the laws bite, that people will respect the laws. Is that okay? Good. So the leader's skill comprised of multiple interpersonal and communication skills. Hence, leaders must hone their leadership abilities. What we are doing right now, we are sharpening. The word hone here means to sharpen. So you sharpen your leadership skills to enhance your abilities to perform. Is that okay? Good. Now, the sources of leadership skills are two, in my view. They are the natural one and the ones we learn. So we call it nature versus nurture. All right? Nature versus what? Nature. We all know nature. Do you understand the word nature? Yes. Do you understand you nurture somebody to grow or you nurture something? Good. So when we talk about nature, let me ask this, because I said it's going to be interactive. What is your belief? Do you think leaders are born or leaders are made? They are both born and made. Good. Who are those in favor of that? Who are those who have a different view? Maybe leaders are born or leaders are made. Who are those who have different views? Speak your mind. If you think differently, let me know. Anybody? Because a handful, there were others who didn't raise their hands. Where do you belong to? Where do you belong? Those of you who didn't raise your hands, where do you belong? Are leaders born? You didn't raise your hand. Are leaders born? They are born. You believe that they are born. Oh, but why didn't you raise your hand? Okay. Yes, you didn't raise your hand. Where do you belong? Are they born? Just born or they are made? They are made. Good. Why do you think they are made?
Because even when people are born from leadership...
Please tell me your names so that... Kwaku? Kwaku Daku. Okay.
So even though leaders are... it comes in the form of heredity. I feel like they are trained as leaders from their birth. So when a prince is born, he's nurtured as a prince. So he naturally gets those leadership qualities.
Okay.
But
good.
If an ordinary person is also born and perhaps was not nurtured to become a leader or king in the future, the person might not have the same skills.
Okay, so you think that leaders are made. All right. Anybody who thinks leaders are born? We have two schools of thought now. Yes?
Okay, I'm Ernest, and I think leaders are born.
Okay.
This is because the ability of somebody to influence cannot be taught. It's an inbuilt character or nature.
Okay.
There are some people who can easily influence people who are not, who may not necessarily be leaders in high places.
Okay.
But they have that ability to influence them. Per the definition, you said a key point in the definition was to influence. So looking at the leadership traits, the key thing we should identify in somebody to be able to tell if this person is a leader is the ability of the person to influence another.
Mm.
So for the example he gave, being born as a prince in a palace does not mean you can influence the people in the community.
Okay.
There are a lot of princes or who have come up, people have rebelled against them.
Okay.
They were not able to influence. So I believe a leader is born.
Okay, people good. So we have three schools of thought. Very interesting, isn't it? So I had to push for that, and that's my responsibility as a leader. I need to get the best out of you, okay? So leaders are born. Somebody thinks leaders are just born. Somebody thinks leaders are just made. I just think leaders is a combination. Leaders are born and made. Okay, let's see how my perspective is that leaders are born and made, a combination. Okay, and I'm going to argue for that. At the university level, you don't have to toe somebody's line if you don't agree. You understand me? We are trained here to sharpen our brains and to argue for what we believe in. Okay, so I believe in the two, a combination. And if you believe in one, you need to argue, like they just said, why they think leaders are born, why they think leaders are made. Why do I think leaders are both born and made? That's the nature and nature. You see, the traits, the motives, and the characteristics required of effective leaders are a combination of hereditary and environment. Okay? The hereditary is the things we pick from our parents. Our cognitive ability is the brain. If I talk about cognitive ability, it's the brain. I remember very well, I read about Lee Kuan Yew, for instance. At a point, he was insisting that graduates married among themselves. Graduates, like you marry your fellow graduates. It was to enhance the cognitive ability of products that will come out of your relationship. Do you understand? Yes. You're learning, you're smiling. So the brains we get, they help us. And the traits we have from our natural environment, they help us. And then, when we see, some people will say, oh, he acts just like the dad, he's very smart, the father was very intelligent, that's so there's no wonder she's also smart. The mom was extremely intelligent, and the kids are. So we pick something from our parents. Do we all agree?
Yes.
Good. And then the environment that we find ourselves in, the brain power we need for creativity requires the right environment to flourish. Let's look at our current environment now. What am I doing? This is the environment. I'm trying to help you sharpen your skills. There are some people you went to school with who are at the end of JSS, they couldn't go to SHS, and they are there, and you went to SHS, and you are at the university and all that. You see, so look at, roll your mind back when you were at, when you completed JHS, and now. Do you see the difference? Yes? Huge? Now we go to secondary school, that at the end of SHS, and now, do you see the difference? Now even let's come to the university, the level 100, and now level 200, do you see the difference? Good. So the environment contributes to sharpening the skills that you have as a leader. And you see, you started with some people, just like the Bible says, the sower went to sow. Some fell in good soil, some fell by the wayside, some fell on rocks and grew and all that. You see, not all of you who started the second primary school are here. Some of them, not because they were not intelligent, but because of maybe financial resources. But in the stricter sense of the word, you are here because you're able to pass your exams and all that. That tells you that you've got a brain. Okay, and now that we are here, we are shaping you. You are going to be our future leaders. Do you understand? So we are saying that the environment, encouragement from others, training, ample opportunity to experiment with all these ideas. When I was at the university, I never got the opportunity to have this forum. Okay, where we bring outsiders, people have made it to talk and all of you. But I was doing that for my students. People will share ideas because I've established my own company and all that. I've been a chief executive officer. I've been a general manager here in London and all those things. So I'm sharing my experiences with you. I'm going to do that. And then you can pick a lot from that and also apply. So in a way, the environment contributes to sharpening the intelligence or the skills that the princess may have, okay, to prepare him. If you look at our various kings now, most of them studied outside, okay? And they make sure that at least you acquire certain skills. Now it's an accepted norm that as a paramount chief, you can't be a paramount chief if you don't have first degree. Your people will not even allow that. It used to be from four, middle school, then it moved to secondary school. Now it's at least first degree, like queen mother or chief, because they think that aspect of sharpening your skill you might have picked from secondary school and from your interactions and what have you with people at the higher level. Is that okay? Does that make sense? Okay. So what are the competencies, the knowledge, the skills, the behaviors needed by an effective leader? We're going to zoom in on that. What you need to be. I am not interested in a leader, or we are not interested in a leader. We are interested in what? An effective leader. Who will make things happen, who will get things happen, who will bring about success in whatever project, whatever endeavor he or she undertakes. We have too many leaders in Africa, and we are not progressing. So your generation, we want to see you as effective leaders. Does that make sense? Good. And even in your homes, some of you are role models for your siblings. You have younger siblings and what have you. You need to be a leader there in your home. You need to be a leader even if there's a project. You know, you do project works and what have you. Some of you are leading the project. So you need to display the qualities of what? Of a leader. So let's not only look at a leader like maybe President Akufo-Addo or maybe the rector or maybe the lecturer. Let's look at it at all levels. You are a mother. Okay? If you're a mother, you're a leader. You're the second in command at home. If you're a sister, you're a leader, you have siblings. Is that okay? Okay, so that is how I want us to be thinking, all right? Don't only look at the top, the middle level and what have you. Everybody is a leader in one way or the other. Does that make sense? If you're not a leader today, you'll be a leader tomorrow. Is that okay? Good. So, you see, the leader is always leading. Look at him. You see the followers. So the leader must lead. That's why we always say leadership by example. Now look at this. There may appear a lot, but leadership effectiveness in many situations. Class captain, class captain, what is the problem? Are you writing the names? What is it that let us all know? You are the attendance. Okay, all right. What did I tell you? You can't be a leader when you make rules and they are flouting the rules and you are looking on unconcerned. It doesn't make you an effective leader. Does that make sense? Whatever rule you come out with, you should be able to implement to get things done. All right? If at home you are in charge of your siblings and you want to tell your little brother to brush his teeth or her teeth or your little sister to brush, before she goes to bed, you have to insist. When you come out with the they will tempt you, they will try you, they will refuse to do it. They will refuse to do it. They will do it deliberately and see if you can insist on that. You are shaking your head. Does that tell you something? Some of us even do that to our parents. There are rules in the house, but you flout it and see if daddy can put his foot down or mommy can put her foot down. True or false? Yes. And when she doesn't put his foot or her foot down, then you fall into the old system. And you cannot bring a change. Is that okay? So be mindful of that. Whatever rule that you come out with, people will deliberately test you and see whether you are the leader who will ensure that the resources and you ensure that, that law is respected. So look at this. The leader must have vision. Where are you? Where do you want to go? And where do you derive the vision? It's from your cognitive ability. Is that okay? Your brain is very important. So you are here. And you must have charisma. A lot of people say ex-President Jerry Rawlings has charisma. Don't you all say that? Have you also heard about Dr. Nkrumah? Desire to lead and leading by example. These are all skills, leadership skills. Now, positivity. We must always be positive about what you are doing. You are here for your university degree. You must be positive and believe in yourself that you're going to get a good class. Is that okay? The accounts will say, "Men boom, well, boom, fear." Don't demean yourself. You must believe in yourself, your ability to get a good class to build on. The leader must be able to give what? Prompt feedback. Do you understand me? Prompt feedback. When you don't allow the situation to pass before you, feedback, if you want feedback to be effective, it has to be prompt. It has to be immediate. So that if the person has done something very well, so thank you very much. That's an excellent job done. Don't leave it till maybe 2 or 3 days or 4 days after. No. He's done a good job, you go ahead to. If he's done something bad, you tell the person to so that the person can correct himself or herself. So feedback should be prompt. Humility. If you're a leader, you have to be humble. Okay? What did I mean by that? You have to know that you don't know everything. What did I tell you from the beginning? I told you that irrespective of my change of degrees, I don't know everything. I'm going to help. I'm going to also learn from you. The moment you say that, you humble yourself. Every situation we find ourselves in is by the grace of God. The fact I'm standing here lecturing you at the moment doesn't mean I'm better than you. There are certain things you know that I don't know. Okay? And by that, it humbles you as a leader. Don't think you know everything as a leader. Be prepared to learn from people. All right? And you must know that when you are a leader, you've been assigned a responsibility to also lead the people. It is not by your mind, but it's by the grace of God that you are leading them at that point in time. That humbles you. So you go to here, you come humility, you have empathy. Do you understand the word empathy? What is empathy?
You see yourself in someone else's
shoes. Excellent, excellent. Clap for yourself, clap for yourself. You put yourself in the person's shoes. So if you are treating that person, okay, the way you are treating the person, or if the person has a problem, imagine yourself in the shoes of that person so you can empathize with the person. A leader must have empathy. There are some people who have no empathy, okay? There are some people who are born sadists. If I say sadist, you understand?
Yes.
Who is a sadist? I said our class will be interactive. Who is a sadist? Anybody here? You said you knew it. I heard your voice. Who is a sadist? Yes.
Someone who enjoys other people's
being sad. Okay, very close. Anybody? Yes. Who is a sadist? This lane. This lane. I want to see this. Who is a sadist? Very soon, all of you are going to be in leadership positions and all that. Anybody who can volunteer? She came close. Who is a sadist? Class captain. What's your name anyway?
Prince,
yes. Somebody, yes? Who lacks compassion? You have taken it to another zone. Yes? Yes, who's a sadist? Simple terms. Come down to my level. Who's a sadist? She was very close. Somebody who enjoys seeing people suffer. There are some lecturers who are very empathetic, true or false. When you are failing, they feel for you, don't they? So they add some more marks for you, don't they? Oh, be honest to yourselves. Show appreciation. Okay, so you see, if you empathize with people, you put yourself in their shoes. When they are suffering, you are concerned. Okay, so when you are a leader and you empathize, it means that the things, when somebody has trouble, for instance, somebody has lost his mom, and you are a manager, the person is emotionally affected. The person may need a compassionate leave, and it is fair to say that, okay, take 10 days or so or 5 days and go and get yourself in the right mood or prepare for your mom's funeral. Because if you were in the person's shoes, you may not be emotionally all right to be coming to work. And whatever support you think you need to give that person during that period, you should be able to do for that person. Because you have put yourself in that person's shoes. Has any of you lost the mom? Not yet. You are too young for that. Okay. But when it's not easy to lose the mom. So if you're a leader and you know that, when somebody loses a mom, you put yourself in the person's shoes and you find a way. If there are certain benefits, you know, that they need to have, you assist them during the trying period. So communication. You cannot be a leader if you cannot talk, if you cannot communicate and communicate effectively. And so all these things, people may be in leadership positions, but we teach them some of these skills. People think that communication is just standing here and talking. Before I came in, he made me aware of your level. Okay? For example, if I'd used the word sadist at the master's level, I wouldn't have bought it. Okay? But at your level, I have to make sure that you understand it. So that by understanding, making sure you understand it, it means I've communicated effectively. All right? Okay. So, integrity. I'm sure we all understand integrity. Integrity. You must be upright in the way you do things. You must ensure that you stick to your morals, your ethics, and everything is upright. Okay. So integrity is very influence. We are talking about influence. Fairness. You can't be a leader when you don't treat people fairly. What is good for the goose is equally good for what? Yes. So that is why in organization there are rules and regulations. In the university there are rules and regulations. We have the opportunity to give you 5 marks free. Is that not the case? Are you not aware? Yes. When you are punctual and you are regular and you are punctual and you are contributing to discussions in class as you are doing now, the lecturer has the maximum five marks to give you. You know that? Yes. And so when everybody has contributed during this and you are giving the 5 marks, why will you, what's your name? Caitlin. Hey, I see a Cambrofuni Yansana. Caitlin, that's a nice name. And then you? Joanna. Okay, I'm familiar with Joanna, but I'm learning Caitlin for the first time. But why should I give Caitlin 5 marks and Joanna 2 marks when both of them have equally contributed? So you're not being very fair. Does that make sense? So a leader must ensure that he treats the followers fairly. The rules and regulations apply to everybody what? Fairly. So the leader must have that skill to do that. And then you must also be genuine, authenticity. Don't be a fake leader. You see, you see him, you stand here, you talk like this, you turn, they go, you do a different thing. Authenticity is a very important skill of a leader, all right? Tolerance of frustration. Never throw your hands up in despair if you're a leader. Okay? If there's a problem, you must always find a solution to the problem. Emotional stability. You must not be flip-flopping. You must be emotionally stable. Have you done emotional intelligence? Not yet. You must be emotional. Look at the way you react when you're angry. Don't respond to mails, you know, that will trigger your emotion quickly. Sober down before you respond. When something goes wrong, maybe in the classroom, at home, among your groups, and you're angry, you don't have to react. Otherwise, you regret the things that you must have said during your anger. When you have sobered down. Is that okay? So the leader must have emotional stability. Extroversion is warm, relating to people warmly. You have to be warm. Who likes eating cold food apart from ice cream? When you go home and the food is in there, what do? You warm it up. So everybody wants to gravitate somebody who is warm. So the leader must be warm. Sometimes when you smile towards people, what do you get? You get, they also smile back. It's infectious. Sometimes even when you are watching films and people are crying, before you realize you're also crying. You see, the person takes you into his world. So you have to be warm when you are dealing with, you need to be able to inspire people if you're a leader. How do you inspire people? You inspire people through words. Through poems, through songs, and what have you, you know. So somebody's words could serve as an inspiration or could be a source of inspiration for somebody. So you can use words, you can use the Bible, you can use so many things to inspire people. Be a source of inspiration for your followers, okay? Let them believe in the ability to do things, all right? Okay. Now, commitment. Love the job you are doing. You are here for what? Your first degree. Be committed to the course you are doing. Every subject you are doing is very important. Everything you are doing here for how many years? 4 years. Why don't you sacrifice and get it done? So you need to be committed. If you're a leader, you need to be committed to the people, the work you are doing. And when you are committed, it rubs on everybody. They will look at you. They will see that, oh, if it's you are supposed to come to work at 8 o'clock, 8 o'clock, you are there, this, you are there, you are doing the job and all that. So your commitment level should be very high so that it will rub on everybody. Assertive. Don't be flip-flopping. Take a decision. Most of us are suffering because our leaders cannot take the right. They cannot stand on their feet or their grounds to take decisions. If you cannot take decisions and you cannot be assertive, you can't be a good leader. Does that make sense? You can consult, though, but there are times you'll be able to consult. There are times it won't be necessary for you to consult. Oh, sorry. You must be enthusiastic about what you are doing. Love what you are doing. Have a sense of humor. Because life is short. Be able to crack jokes with your people. Does that make sense?
Yes.
Crack jokes with your people. Life is short. Self-confidence is the precursor to what? An effective leadership. Self-confidence. Wow. You need to learn how to be self-confident. You need to, one, believe in yourself. How do you also become self-confident? You become self-confident when you know your subject. Whatever you are doing, know it well as a leader. If you are managing an organization, know the organization very well. If it's a project you are managing, know the project very well. Okay, because you'll be the last source. When they have a problem, they will come and consult you. Sometimes they will deliberately even consult you to find out if you know that what you are doing. Sometimes you access lectures, you access questions, and you know the answers. True or false?
True.
You are testing us.
Yes.
It's a fact. In this day and age where people can easily Google and check on those things, oh, they will check on you. I remember when I came here, I think I was teaching level 200 like this, and then when we went on break, one of my students came closer to me and said, "What is super old?" Ashanti, they like this. They know how to coin words and what have you. I said, "What do you mean by what is so?" I said, "What is super?" And I said, "I don't understand you." He said, "Oh, the things you do, we double check. Whatever you are teaching, we double check. And when we double check, we find out that it's true." So what I'm trying to tell you is that for you to be self-confident, you must know the subject. If it's a job you are doing, have control over your position and everything. That gives you the self-confidence. You cannot be a leader if you are not self-confident. Even the way you talk, your voice. Sometimes when you go to a place and you're frightened, don't your voice shiver? Doesn't it shiver? Doesn't your voice shiver? Yes. The person will know straight away that you are lacking confidence. So wherever you go and you are talking and your voice shivers, then there's a problem. That's okay? And everything flows through you. So your self-confidence, it starts from it's from the brain. And that is why I'm saying that when you know the subject matter very well, you develop what? You are not talking like somebody who has self-confidence. When you know the subject very well, you become what? Yes. And even the way you talk, they will know whether you are self-confident or what? Or not. So these are some of the skills you need to have as a leader. I've added a few. You see that you need to be patient when you are dealing with people. The leader must have some what? Some patience. You need to what? Be an active listener. That is why God gave us one mouth and 2 ears. I'm not playing God, but I presume. That's why he gave us one mouth and 2 ears. So you listen and talk a little. Everybody wants attention. We have a situation in our country where our leaders, before you finish talking, he has given you the answer. You can see that what you are saying, the man is not listening. His mind is made up. The followers will know, and that is a mark of a bad leader. When we were at Lagos, we had a medical officer. I don't want to. Anytime you went there, you know, they were coming on shift 1 week. They will come and look they will come and be at the student's clinic for 1 week. Before you sit down, this doctor would have finished writing the prescription. Before you sit down. You see? So nobody was going. When he came, a few people were just going there. But what I'm trying to tell you is that everybody likes to be given a listening ear. So if you're a leader, try as much as possible to give your people the listening ear. Does that make sense? Okay. So be dependable, somebody they can rely. We must also be reliable. And you must be creative. And you see, the creativity here comes from what? The brain and the vision. That's why we talk about team building. You must be able to resolve conflict. You must be able to carry everybody along. That is crucial for a leader. Is that okay? Good. Flexibility, risk taking. You must take calculated risk. A leader must take what? It's an aspect of your leadership skills. Then ability to teach and mentor people. You have to be what? Accountable. All right? You have to be what? Accountable. We have problems in Africa because our leaders are not accountable. They don't want to be held accountable. They think that they are in their own world. Whatever they do, they should be left alone. But if you're a leader, you are accountable to your people. You cannot be a leader and not be accountable. All right? So if you look at some of the key traits, one, your competencies, I've talked about it, your ability to know the job, what you are doing, know it well. Your character. Your character is very important, one of the elements, and your commitment. So three C's, remember me with that. Your character, your competencies, and your what? Commitment. If you have these three things, three skills as a leader, it will take you far. Any questions so far? Okay, I'll give a bit of my time. 2 minutes. Look at the person closer to you and tell him what you have been able to absorb so far. Oh, you are alone. So tell me what you have taken in so far. What have you learned so far? It's important. Don't read. I want you to tell me. Yeah? By the way you talk will let me know whether you have self-confidence or not. So talk like somebody who has you are developing self-confidence, and I'm teaching you how to develop that. So tell me, yes. You need to be self-confident, huh? What else?
You need to build a strong relationship.
Build a strong relationship.
You need to have effective communication.
Communication, good. Okay, those of you at the corner, what did the man in green shirt say? He said we are confident. Okay. You said, no, what he has learned so far, not what your traits. What have you learned so far? I'm saying that, what have you learned so far? That is what we were discussing. We have had a little chat, a discussion. What have you how have you understood the lecture? What have you learned so far? What did he tell you about what he has learned? Were you looking at your traits? Oh, okay. I'm interested in what you have learned so far. Okay? Okay. He said you have... Yes? What did he say? What did he tell you? So the two of you got the question wrong. You didn't understand the question. All right. Okay. Okay. What did she say? What's her name?
Shika.
Okay. What did Shika tell you? What she had learned so far? Please, you are listening to the two here. Mm-hmm. Such as... They're supposed to be fair. Committed. Okay. What did you tell Shika? What's your name? Yasmin. What did Yasmin say?
Okay, so Yasmin said leaders are both born to lead.
Good.
And, leaders are both born and made, and then leaders should have empathy, and then they should be fair to people.
Okay. That's very good. The two ladies at the back, we'll end with you.
She says leaders must be mindful of their time. And then also, if you're a leader, you should be able to communicate to be an effective leader, you are supposed to communicate well.
Okay.
And then, as a leader, you must humble yourself and be ready to learn from others.
Good. What did she also tell you?
She said, as a leader, you must be ready to take risks.
You say calculated risks.
Yes, and you should also be confident.
Let's listen to them, please.
And you should also be confident. And then set an example for others to learn.
Good. You see, when you are leading, when people are talking, you are talking, you know what happens? It tells them that you are disrespecting them. And it can affect what? Your relationship with those people. And you cannot be a leader when you don't want to rupture the relationship with your followers. So wherever you are, when people are talking, just have the patience to
listen to them. Okay? And you concentrate on what they are saying. Sometimes I feel very sad when I see our parliamentarians, somebody is talking behind, he's on his phone. It's a mark of bad leadership. Somebody is debating, and you expect him to listen and contribute. He's talking on phone. When you watch the British Parliament, do you see anybody talking on phone in Parliament? No. So these things, I'm pointing out these things for you to know. When you get there, you don't do that. Okay? You don't do that. So, you see, these are the types of leadership styles people use. I'm sure you might have heard about charismatic, autocratic, democratic, laissez-faire, transactional, transformational, situational. You know, do you know about them? Yes. It is they apply the traits that we have just discussed. They use the traits and it affects the style of leadership. This one is charismatic. They have the unnatural power, the powers that, supernatural power, they will say, that they're able to get things done more than the normal human being can do. So people follow them because of that. People, autocratic, when they take the decision final, they don't give you room to contribute. Democratic, they allow you to contribute. Okay? Laissez-faire, they sit back and allow you to have your own way, and when you have a problem, you go to them. Okay? Transactional is that they pay money to get things done. Those of you who are doing marketing, they set targets. Okay, Dr. Yerson will tell you, they set targets. And when you meet the target, they pay you. They pay you for that. When sometimes they give you commission, or they give the whole group that you have met your target. So that's an aspect of transactional leadership. Transformational leadership, they help you to grow and they develop you for higher performance. We are here, we want to change, we want to go this way. And so they take you from where you are to a new place, and they make you understand what are the benefits that the new place would be. Situational leadership is when you have people like over here, you study them. There are four levels. We have what we call telling, selling, participating, and delegating. So at any point in time, you know the level of the follower. If I'm telling, if the person is at the telling level, you give more directive, okay, and lower support. If the person is at participating, you are directing, you are supporting. High direction, high support. Okay, if the person is, selling. If the person is at selling level, you are directing, you are supporting. If the person is participating, low direction, high support. If the person is at a level that he knows the job, you delegate. And that one, low direction, low support. All right, so the leader must know the level of his followers and be able to provide the needed support. Does that make sense? Okay, it's because of the time. These are some of the skills you can combine, you can use. I'm dwelling much on these skills because that will make you an effective leader. You must have a strategic thinking. That is what we talk about. This is where you are, the vision. Now, this is you want to achieve a vision. You want to get a first class, don't you? How do you want to get it? How do you want to get a first class? Planning. You plan, you know how to achieve the vision, know how to deal with the challenges. Getting a first class doesn't come cheap. Or getting a second upper doesn't come cheap. So you plan. You are doing your course. You belong to a study group. You are doing your work on time. You are doing other things. You are consulting your lecturers. Sometimes you go the extra mile. I had a student who will answer questions on his own and bring them to me to read, to help him. Okay? He was doing these things on his own. I didn't give them the question. After the assignment, he will go extra to do his own assignment, different assignment, and bring it to me to read, to correct him. Eventually, he got an A in the paper. So you see the planning and the delivery. And then you must know how to manage people. Because as a leader, you are working with and you are working with people. You must know everybody's characteristics and know how to deal with them. People management is extremely important. When you come here, change management. Things will happen along the way when you want to achieve your vision. Sometimes you may touch wood. Something may happen along the way. You may even not be getting the books you want to read. Some people may even get suspended. Something may happen, but then you need to alter your plans and move forward. Sometimes you may lose even your father or your mom, touch wood, and because of that, it will affect the payment of your school fees. So how do you adjust in working towards your getting your first class? Does that make sense? So be able to adjust on the way. Communication, we have talked about that. Persuasion and influence. You must be able to persuade people. You must be able to influence people. Does that make sense? So how do you develop? It's one of the things how do you develop your vision? Know what you want to do or where you want to go. I'm now on how to help you develop. Okay? Self-confidence, we'll talk about it. Know the subject matter or know your job very well. Leading by example, practice what you preach. Does that make sense? Okay. Integrity, be morally and ethically upright. If you talk about moral and ethics, it's about not doing the wrong things. You know this is wrong. You don't do it. Okay? You don't steal. Don't steal the company's money. You are the boss of this place. So, like the Nigerian singer would say, "Oga de chop am nyafu 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 nyafu." You have access to them, so don't steal. Honesty and trust. Your yes should be your yes, your no should be your no. You have to be honest. Trustworthiness in a relationship, trust is what? Key. If you catch your girlfriend or your boyfriend cheating, what happens? It undermines the trust. True or false? You slap him. You see? So trust is very key in every relationship. Don't forget that we said leadership is a relationship that you have with your followers. So when they lose the trust in you, forget it. Look at what they did to some of the African leaders. They went on demonstration and all that because they lost the trust in them, and eventually they kicked them out. And it happens elsewhere, many places. Empathy, we've talked about empathy. How do you develop empathy? Always put yourself in the shoes of the person, other people. Okay. Assertiveness, be firm and take decisions. Communication, we've talked about that. Team building, you must have the art of resolving conflicts. Don't be the one, you're going to say, what's your name?
Anita.
And you?
Temi.
Temi, have you heard what Anita said about you? Anita said this because she said, but please don't tell her I told you. You have leaders who behave like that. They knock people's heads together and they call it divide and rule. Because they don't want you to be united. Because if you are united, you can fight them. But they put in things that will divide the group so that they can rule them. Does that make sense? It is a bad way of leading people. Because when they eventually get to know what you are doing, they will also gang up against you. And it also affects performance and what have you. So no divide and rule. Team building, commitment, dedication, and loyal to the cause. So how do you develop expected challenges. When you are developing the skills, there will be challenges. Is that not the case?
Yes, sir.
What are some of the... Revise your vision due to lack of resources. Sometimes you want to get something done. You want to set up your own business. You want to do this. But then somewhere along the line, you run out of finances. What do? You don't share. You revise it. Maybe you wanted it at this level. You can start on a lower level. Okay? So whatever challenges you are having, please just pause to revise. But don't shelve it. Selling your vision to others who may not believe in it. There are some people, you work like it, well, wait my way. You can't do it. No, wait, when you finish university. If you're not careful, they will kill your vision. But some of you can start something even at this level. So if you are a leader and you want to influence people to get things done, when they don't believe in it, it is your duty as the leader to Let them understand the advantages and the benefits of doing those things. I told you a while ago that if you don't get anything I say, what? Stop me and ask me. I gave you the benefits, didn't I?
Yes.
Yes. So if the person understands the benefit, you can carry the person along. Initially, when I said, some of you were like, oh, who is this guy? But after giving you the benefits, you realize that, oh, that's something to what the man is saying. So when people, when you may have challenges, but be able to master and know your job like the back of your palm, that gives you advantage. That gives you advantage in leading people. Okay? Managing people with different characteristics, especially the difficult ones. Some of you are difficult by nature. But the moment you see, it may be that you may see, this is how they say that the person is difficult by nature. But the person may not be difficult. It's the way you understand the person. If you disagree with the person, it doesn't mean the person hates you. If you are pushing ideas and the person doesn't seem to understand you and he's questioning you, he doesn't hate you. We Africans, we have a belief that if the person criticizes you, he's your enemy. If you are bringing something, a person is not clear, he's questioning you and all that, asking for clarification, he's your enemy. No. The person is rather giving you the opportunity to explain further some of the things that will let me buy into your vision. Does that make sense? Don't, because we do that, African leaders always have yes people around them. If they say somebody say yes man, do you understand it?
Yes.
Chief, be happy WhatsApp. Everything is going well. Chief, they are happy. Election, you better fight. Chief. Don't mind him. So you have yes people around you. It is only when you leave the scene, then you see the reality. But if you welcome criticisms, if people don't understand you and you take the trouble to tell them what you mean, and you don't take offense because they've criticized you, that will make you a better leader. Does that make friends? Does that make sense? I hate people who will always say, oh, you are good, you are good. When I'm with you as a friend, I want you to be able to tell me when I go wrong. It is the person who likes you who will tell you when you go wrong. If he's telling you all the good things, and so from so, are you God? No. So your friend, you must create a situation where your friend can tell you what you do that is wrong. Especially if he's the bankroller, if he's the one buying the food and what have you, and you are not sure whether how he will take it when you hold back. True or false? Yes. Because when you don't hold back, you criticize him, you say, oh, Charlie, But what I mean is that person will get into trouble. That person must be able to welcome criticisms. The person who loves you will tell you when you go wrong, okay? You may also have pressure from friends when you are doing the right things. Sometimes they'll say, are you more pious than the Pope? Is there work for you? This is Abayi Juma. Is it for your father? Is Gimpa for your father? Mamon chose more. But those are the challenges that you have as a leader when you want to be upright. We've had students who have messed up their colleagues' fans. We've had students who have been so corrupt. Have you heard about it?
Yes.
Yes. That's how it starts. Leaders. Because they think they are leaders, they have access to your resources, the 25 cedis you pay, they think they want to mess the whole thing up. Yes. And it gets them into trouble. Do you understand? So those of you who are coming through the walls of the university, you are going to be our future leaders. So when you go wrong, you have to be told that you've gone wrong. So you have to be morally upright. Carry everybody along with you. Don't discriminate if you're a leader. Carry along everybody with you. Even when you become mothers and fathers, and you have children, make sure you carry all of them along with you as a leader. The moment you start discriminating, you are creating a problem among your siblings. If your mother loves your sister more than you, how do you feel? And he shows it openly. Yes. So that is it. When you are a leader and you show your biases so openly, you drive especially most of the good people away from you. And if, with the siblings, the worst is that it divides them. Okay? Okay. So how do you deal with the challenges? We have said it, but I'm just summing up for you. Be fair in dealing with people and dealing with everybody. And when you have a business as a leader, recruiting people to work for you is extremely important. Recruitment is like garbage in, garbage out. If you don't recruit the right people with the right skills, they won't be able to perform well for you, and you, the leader, will have problems. Does that make sense? Yes. So pay attention to recruitment. Even if you have started a small business now, okay, and you're hiring somebody, make sure the person has the needed expertise for the job you are doing. Okay? Okay. Now, build a culture of good relationship with everybody. Don't harbor grudges. Some of us are good at that. Some of us are what? Good at harboring grudges. Payback time. I'll show you that I am in charge. I'll show you that. When somebody offends you, especially offends you, and don't hold any grudge against, you can't be an effective leader if you are holding grudges against people. No. All right? You see, the person who is closer to you is the one who will offend you. All right? The person who doesn't relate with you every day will not offend you. So when people offend you, please point it out to them and don't hold grudges. It's really not good for a good leader. Don't attempt to please everybody. You end up pleasing nobody. If the person is wrong, tell him in the face that he's wrong. Don't please everybody because you will end up pleasing nobody and you will be a bad leader. Okay?
Sometimes when the person offends you, you feel like, okay, maybe because I gave too many chances to that person, that is why that person had the ability to do what he or she did. So maybe you think, or I want to shut that door of chances.
You see, you have said sorry. Once you say sorry, I should be able to forgive you. That's what I mean by harboring grudges. When the person offends you and says sorry, that should be it. You don't go back to it. You don't hold it at the back of your mind to look for an opportunity to pay him or pay her back. You can't be an effective leader if you do that. Now, the opportunity you have given the person, every leader must have a red line that people cannot cross. There must be a red line. All right? So what I mean by that is that, you see, when you are harboring grudges, it affects your relationship with the person. And you're always looking for an opportunity to pay back, to show the person where power lies. And that will affect your relationship with that person and the entire group. Is that okay? Learn to forgive and forget and move on. Okay? Maybe you see the contribution you've made. If I was going to say that, oh, but I've said that people should not talk in class and she's talking, so she's disrespecting me as the leader. So I'm going to show her where power lies. Do you see that we wouldn't have benefited from your contribution?
Yes.
Yes. So you don't hold grudges. Don't be a hypocrite. Be a true person. Don't be a hypocrite. There are so many hypocrites. Train, develop, coach, and mentor staff. If you're a leader, train people and mentor them. You see, in life, everybody wants to grow. You see, what we are trying to do for you to help you to grow, you will never forget it. Will you forget it? What Dr. Yosin is doing to help you guys to grow, to become good leaders, arranging facilitators to come, you forever remember. You forever remember for that. Human beings are not like candles. They don't whittle. They want to grow. So everybody who is helping you to grow, you become loyal to the person and you appreciate it. When you join an organization, you want to rise to the top. You've come to the university, you want to finish your course. Anybody at all who is contributing to your progress, wouldn't you be happy in relating with the person? You will. Your head of department, your dean, your lecturers, you will. Wouldn't you? So a leader must always help people to grow. You need to delegate. You cannot do everything. Even in your classroom, the class captain must delegate some functions. Don't you delegate sometimes? Yes. Okay? Operate within your means. Plan and budget for your resources. Operate within your means. Some of us, our leaders, are getting into trouble because they don't plan the resources that they have. Before you realize, they are dipping their hands into other areas and they get into trouble. So in whatever area you find yourself as a leader, whether there's a project that you are doing and all that, make sure you operate within the resources. Live within your means. That is crucial for a leader. If you don't live within your means, you are going to have problems. That's why a lot of leaders are thrown into what? Into prison. Finally, let's talk about motivation. That's going to be very quick. All right? A leader must be able to motivate his people to get them to do the job. True or false? And what is motivation? It is concerned with the strength and direction of behavior and the factor that influence people to believe, to behave in a certain way. You see the word influence? The factors that will influence you to behave in a certain way underpin motivation. The factors, they underpin what? Motivation. Why will I get up and go to school? Why will I get up and attend lectures every day? Because I'm working towards getting what? A first class, a second class, a good class. Is that not the case? Why will I be attentive in class? Because I want to hear what the lecturer is saying. Most of the time, when you listen very well in the lecture room, you pick some of the questions the lecturer will ask eventually. Try it and see. Be attentive. When he says it, jot it down. You will meet it in the exam. So when you are very attentive in class and all that, the things that the lecturer will say, oh, this thing is very important. Take note. Jot it down. Take note. So sometimes, that is why I tell you, you have to concentrate when you are in class. Every lecturer has his own way of lecturing. So take note of all this. All right? Okay. So you we'll talk about motivation. You see here, your needs. You want to get a first, it moves here. What you need will serve as a driving force. And then your goals. So when you achieve your goals, you realize that you become fulfilled. When you entered admission at Gimpa, what happened? You completed your form, you were urging, you were desirous, the things they asked you to do, you followed, and eventually when you got to admission, let's say, how did you feel? Yes, you are also going to university. And now you come to the university, another goal starts. How to get good results. Okay? So once a goal is fulfilled, another goal emerges. So that goal will drive you, that will motivate you to do well. What are some of the motivational skills? As you see, there are actions and strategies that produce a desired behavior or response from the stakeholder. The desired behavior. You see, you're all listening because you want to get something. So you are looking at the motivator, you are looking at your target audience, you are looking at the personality. Does that make sense? Good. Now, I'm just teaching you a bit about motivation. We have what we call the intrinsic. You have the extrinsic, you have the altruistic. Have you heard about that before? The intrinsic comes from within us. There are three types of motivation. The intrinsic comes from what? Within us. Your job satisfaction and everything. Money cannot buy that. And it lasts longer. For instance, if you look at the feelings you have, the challenges you have, the interesting aspect, the subjects you like, the things you like over here. When you go to the classroom, how do you feel? You want to listen to the teacher, okay? And there are so many things that you cannot use money to buy. The fact that you are at the university and you want to get a first class, it is motivating enough. If they even give you 1 million, that will not last. 1 million, you spend 1 million. But the drive in you to get the right results, the good grades, okay, will last longer. Now, when you come out extrinsic, the clothes, the pay rise, the things, they are all external. But the intrinsic one is within you, and that is the drive, and that is what will last longer. The altruistic one, there are some people, it's about love, socializing with people. And there are some of you, when your friend is having a party, you can spend the whole week organizing the party for the person. That is the satisfaction you derive. Some of you derive the satisfaction in what? Helping others. Is that okay? Some of you, if a colleague misses a class and he comes, you take the trouble to walk the person through what happened and all that. You get some satisfaction from that. So that is altruistic. So I'm quickly going to go on. You see, at the workplace, people have economic needs. So at the workplace, they want economic rewards, pay and what have you, okay? And then the intrinsic is the job satisfaction he gets. He's doing a certain job and he's happy with the job he's doing. So he gets that satisfaction, and that is what drives him. When he gets up and he's going, or there's a challenge and he's able to resolve that problem, he gets the satisfaction. All right? For instance, when you're calculating mathematics and or when you have a problem and you're all trying to resolve it and you're having challenges and you're able to nail it, how do you feel? You feel satisfied. All right? Okay. Quickly, let's move on. So reasons why a leader must motivate members is to reduce boredom. When people are bored, They feel they are not, and you find them relaxed. So if you're a leader, when you motivate people, they don't get bored. If you're a leader, you bring new prospects or new revenues. If you're a leader and you ensure job satisfaction, it gives people mental peace of mind. You see, the mental peace of mind is the way you relate with them and the way they feel comfortable in dealing with you. And when they are comfortable in dealing with you, it motivates them and you are able to get the best out of them. If you are antagonizing them, if somebody is antagonizing, how do you relate with the person? The moment you see the person, you even get angry. And it triggers certain things in you, and you are not able to perform as expected. So ensure job satisfaction and avoid jealousy. Jealousy is a disease. So avoid jealousy and prejudices. And then you assist people meet deadlines. We are going to end very soon. Expected challenges. What are the expected challenges? Motivating yourself daily. Every day you need to motivate yourself as a leader. Whatever went wrong yesterday, don't allow it to affect you. So you need to motivate yourself before you can motivate others. And you can use so many things, like sometimes you use music, sometimes you use other lyrics, you read the Quran, you read the Bible, you read people's success stories. When they were in the university, what they went through and other things and how they were able to make it. Those are the things that you need to also you do, and then they motivate you. Don't you do that. So if you don't do that, try to do that. And the leader must get himself motivated before he can motivate other people. Okay? So motivate yourself. Look for aspects. Motivating people at work. Make the most everything. Look, some of you don't like mathematics. Some of you are having problems with statistics. And some of you are failing statistics because you are not motivating yourself to understand the subject. Don't see any subject as difficult. Find a way of addressing those challenges. A colleague of yours may be very good at statistics and what have you. I know some people have finished the school and they're still trailing statistics. Do you want to do that? No. So when you're having challenges, the moment you block your mind that, look, this subject is difficult, when the lecturer is standing in front of you, you cannot concentrate on it. You cannot concentrate on anything he says. But you tell yourself that this statistics, I'm going to crack it. I will not repeat it. I will not rewrite it. But the saying that you have some motivation and it opens up your mind and you are able to follow. If you have challenges, you ask him and you put in the effort before you realize you are having control over the subject. Don't see any subject as beyond you that you cannot do whilst here. Is that okay? That will drive you to address the challenge that you may be having. When you work with lazy people, don't give up on them. Try to carry them along. Some of you get angry, especially when you have a project work and they have left it alone to you. Have you had that experience before? Provide new opportunities for them to grow. All right? Create harmonious relationship among the people all the time. Let the environment be conducive for people to operate within. Nobody likes a toxic environment. Nobody likes an environment that is not conducive. So you need to create an enabling environment for people to. Even if you keep pets and you are hostile towards the pet, once the pet is, it moves away. Right? Even animals. So everybody wants what? A positive environment. Okay? Provide the needed assistance. Set challenging and attainable goals for people. All right? Reward hard work. When people work hard, reward them. Otherwise, those who are not working hard in organizations, you have people who are lazy and they are the people who gossip. Don't reward them for gossiping. Sorry?
Because they have nothing to do.
Yes. And so if you reward them for gossiping, it means the hardworking people will no longer work hard. But you have to reward hardworking. Like somebody has written an essay, he has done it so well. Reward him with the marks. Do you understand me? When you get your paper and you have an A, how do you feel? Yes. And you know how you go about it? Say, I got an A in your paper. But when you get a C, you see, you gave me C. Then we say that you got the C. I didn't give you the C. But when she gets an A, she won't say you gave her an A or you gave her an A. Say, I got an A in your paper. So don't get a C, all right? Don't let anything discourage you. Don't let things discourage you, okay? All right. Recognize the team achievement and respect team members and everybody. That's a way to motivate people. The key aspect of leadership, one word I'll leave you with, is respect your team members. respect every member of your team. Every member of the team is important. Accord them the needed respect. Respect is earned. You can't get respect by having the position. Okay, it's the way you will respect the people. And every member, when you are leading people, everybody has an important role to play. And that is why even in the Bible, Jesus Christ said, when you have 100 sheep and you lose one, go and look for that one. How can you leave 99 and go and look for one? If you come and the 99 are gone. But the significance is that every member of the team is very, very important. On that note, I want to thank you for your audience and your attention and everything. If you have any questions, please ask. We have some few minutes for questions. Okay. Yes.
When you have a leader who lacks some of the leadership
skills, yeah.
How will you deal with that?
Such as, give me one example.
Like, she's a leader, and then, like, she has a problem with her character. How will you deal with that person? You have to approach.
Okay, let's say for instance he gets angry easily. Okay, are we all agree on that example?
Yes.
Good. If the person gets angry easily, you don't talk back when he's angry and he's talking to you. You don't talk back. You take it easy. All right? And you don't hold it against that person. You identify that is his character. He gets angry easily, so he has anger management problem. You understand me? So everybody has his good time and his bad times, all right? There will be a time that he'll be in the right mood. Or let's say, for instance, you annoy me as a lecturer and I'm lecturing now. And I say, look, why are you behaving like this? Look, if you cannot take this, get out. And you go on. You don't stand exchanging words with the lecturer or your leader. Then maybe you go back and say, later on you can go and see the person and say, look, say, I didn't do that because of, I think you got it wrong, you got me wrong. I meant this, I meant that. So if that was the case, I'm sorry. Okay, I'm very sorry about it. That is how you handle people. But the key thing is to study every leader, everybody, study every lecturer. Every lecturer, because we all have our various characteristics. As I stand here, if you ask my students, they will tell you. Just principled.
When you become, you create a relationship with someone.
Yeah.
As a leader.
Yeah.
Sometimes it gets to a point, you become so familiar with the person. And sometimes that when you know that as for this thing, the leader tells me to do it and I don't do it, you won't do anything. Mm-hmm. Because you are familiar with that person. Mm-hmm. So how can you acquire such familiarity when you have such people in your organization?
Good. You have to make sure that when it comes to the job, you are going by the rules. Did you see how I behaved? Even your class captain, I call him to order. It doesn't mean I don't like him. So when the rules are there, ensure the rules are. If even he's your friend, make sure that he respects the rules, the regulations and everything, because other people are watching. If you don't sanction him, they will also behave the way he behaved. Do you understand? And then you cross the line. You have to, there must be a red line where people cannot cross. The problem we have is that maybe you go out to drink omutu with him, you chase girls with the person and all that, so he brings it to work. And if you don't discipline him, it will affect the performance. When you get to the job, everything must be according to the rules, the procedures, and what have you, okay? So that you get a job done. We have what we call relationship-related and tax-related. I didn't teach you that. I didn't mention that. But every leader must know how to relate with people, but must ensure that the job is done. If you don't get a job done, you are being a poor leader. We have an objective to achieve as a leader. We had an objective to achieve to get through this. So if I came here and I was overdwelling on so many things and we're laughing, blah, 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 and at the end of the day, we don't get it done, I've been a poor facilitator. You can achieve whatever you want to achieve in the whole wide world. The future is so bright and huge, and it will be there for you. The world, you can achieve everything you want to achieve. You don't go through the walls of university and become useless. Take note of that. If you want to be useless, it will be you. It will not be us teaching you. You don't go through the walls of university and become what?
Useless.
You go through the world of university and become what?
Useful.
Useful to yourself, to your family, and society, and your country. And I'm saying that your generation, we should have what? Effective leaders. On that note, thank you very much, and God bless you.